Good evening, everyone. It's great to see so many of you out here tonight to welcome Thi Bui to Salt Lake City. My name is Kim Cornick, and I'm the director of the Asia Center at the University of Utah. So first, I want to tell you a little bit about our center. The Asia Center serves as a hub for Asia-related activities at the University of Utah, involving teaching, research, as well as outreach to K-12 schools and the broader community. The center supports Asian studies in its broadest sense, incorporating the languages and countries of East, South, Southeast, and Central Asia, as well as Russia, the Pacific, and West Asia. We are also really focused on the Asian diaspora and Asian immigrants within our community and country. The Asia Center teamed with many co-sponsors to bring Thi Bui to Salt Lake City. We want to make sure that we acknowledge them and thank them for their support. So we have, from the University of Utah, the Office of Equity and Diversity, the Division of Ethnic Studies, the Department of Writing and Rhetoric Studies, the Creative Writing Program in the Department of English, the Tanner Humanities Center, the Tanner Human Rights Center, the Center for Research on Migration and Refugee Integration, the College of Humanities, the College of Education, and the Center for Ethnic and Student Affairs. So thank you. There are also several community partners that we want to acknowledge: Utah Humanities, the Salt Lake City Public Library for this great space, and the King's English Bookstore. And I just want to note that you probably noticed they'll be selling copies of the books outside, and there'll be a book signing after the Q&A as well, so be sure to stick around for that. And we'll have a Q&A moderated by Paisley Rexall from the Department of English here at the University of Utah. And then I wanted to turn the mic over to Lehua Kona. She is a student at the University of Utah. She is Director of Social Justice in the U's Asian American Student Association and is also currently studying Asian Studies and International Studies. So we're happy to have Lehua come up and introduce our speaker.
Sorry, I'm really short. As Professor Cornick said, I am a current undergraduate student at the University of Utah. I am really, really honored to introduce Thi Bui to you all tonight. For some background on Thi Bui, if you haven't heard of her before, she first started teaching high school in New York City. After moving to California, she became one of the founding teachers for Oakland International High School. This high school specifically focuses on immigrants coming to the United States and learning English as their second language. She taught there for several years to incoming students from all different backgrounds, and she is currently a professor at the California College of Fine Arts in the Master of Fine Arts Comic Program. Her debut novel, The Best We Could Do, was published in 2017, which pieces together her family's accounts from their immigration from Vietnam to the United States. She and her family immigrated to the United States in 1978 as the boat people, as a part of the boat people seeking refuge from Southeast Asia. These accounts and her personal own accounts about growing up in the United States creates a very emotional story that most of you have all read. Her debut novel received numerous awards all across the country, such as the American Book Award, the Book List, the Bill Gates Best of Year Book List, and many more. Within the same year, she also illustrated Bao Fei's children book, A Different Pond, and this year she has collaborated with Viet Thanh Nguyen and his son and her own son for their book Chicken of the Sea. And she is currently working on a graphic novel focused on how Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders are affected by detention and deportation. For me, as an Asian American college student, there are not many role models to depart from the traditional career paths of doctors or lawyers, but Thi Bui and her story have motivated me to pursue a different path among my Asian American peers. She has shown me that I can be a successful Asian American woman no matter my choices, and I hope other Asian Americans are inspired by her story and continue to push through their adversity to reach their goals. Without further ado, here's Thi Bui.
Thank you so much, Lehua. It's an honor to be called somebody's role model. I was lucky to have an older sister who went to law school, who talked me out of going to law school. But I still double majored, like a lot of good immigrant kids. I did art and legal studies. But here I am, a cartoonist, but it's been a long and winding road, and I'm happy to tell you, regale you with stories about my failures along the way. I almost flunked out of grad school, but I went to grad school twice and did better the second time. I'm here to talk to you about the best we could do and also some of my more current work. I'm going to start some time here just to make sure that I have time for questions later. The best we could do is called an illustrated memoir. Some people call it a graphic memoir. It's not one of those memoirs where like somebody great lived an amazing life and then sat down to tell you their story. I'm a very ordinary person. My family is a very ordinary family. The reason why I wrote this story is because our story is common to hundreds of thousands of people in the US, but that story is not very well understood. Instead, I grew up with a lot of bad Vietnam War movies, which I took revenge on by making this book. But it took me so long to make it that by the time I was, you know, really writing it, I was much older and softer. And so it became a book not just about taking revenge on like American stereotypes of me. It became a vehicle to ask questions about my origins. Everybody kind of wonders about their origin story. For me and my family, that search for an origin story required understanding the causes of our displacement. And also it required me to look more deeply into my relationships with my parents, who come from a very different life experience, and sometimes they were hard to understand. I took all of this jumbled mess of a life experience and all of this history that I tried to learn about from many different angles, and I made it into a book with pictures that has fewer than 50,000 words, and that took a long time too. And it is, of course, framed by my questions and my perspective. So as my mother would say, it's probably 99% true. I'm going to introduce you to the characters. Can I get a sense of who has not read the book? Oh, wow, okay. All right. So the characters are my sisters, Lan and Bic, who were much older when we left Vietnam. My mother, who I call Ma in the book, who was 8 months pregnant when we left. And my father, who I call Bo, and that's little three-year-old me. And I'm gonna, actually, before jumping into reading to you an excerpt of The Best We Could Do, I'd like to start with something I wrote more recently called Precious Time, because I think this relates to something I learned about your state a couple of days ago. I learned that your governor wrote a letter to President Trump requesting that more refugees be allowed to resettle in here in Utah, which I think is amazing and wonderful. And I had a tour today of the Office for Refugee Services, and I was amazed at the level of support there is for newcomers. But this is something that I wrote right after the presidential election, and it was about my worry about how things were gonna change for refugees. There's nothing like losing your country when you're little to help you see nationalism as the strange and unnatural thing that it is. When I was three, my parents packed our family and all our hopes into a cargo hold of a riverboat and set out to sea. We humans here are about to waste a whole lot of precious time and resources fighting over who gets what. And this often happens when there are major upheavals in the world. Sometimes it happens because some people are hoarding most of the resources. Both these conditions are currently in place. From space, all of this seems commonplace and small. It's happened before. But down here on Earth, our decisions matter. And this is an image that I took from the news of a three-year-old Syrian boy whose family put him into a boat, set out to sea to try to find a better home for their family. They didn't make it, he didn't make it. When I saw the image, I was very affected because of the similarity in our stories and our journeys, and I felt survivor's guilt. And I wanted to call attention to the refugee crisis that I was seeing in the news, but I'm not sure if I should have used this image, and it's been something that I've been thinking a lot about in the last couple of years. How do we represent refugees in a way that actually helps them? So actually, one of the answers that I figured out for myself lies in the work that I already did in The Best We Could Do, which tells the story of my family in pictures, and the only photographs in the book are our refugee identification pictures, but you don't see them until almost the end of the book. And for me, it was very, very important to present this out of that framework of refugees, so that you could understand who you were as people before we came, before we became boat people. So to help everybody get a taste of how the story goes, I would love for some volunteers tonight to help me do the reading, because there are a lot of voices and I don't want to do them all. These are the photos I was telling you about. Everybody has them who went through the camps. But let's do the characters. I need somebody who doesn't mind microphones. Microphones are a lot of fun, by the way. Who would read Ma's parts out loud from the screen. And it could be someone of any gender, but just somebody who's willing to take a risk. Yes, fantastic. Do you want to come down to the front row? What's your name? Lang, thank you. And could I have somebody else play my father, Bo? Great. Do you want to come to the front row? Because we have three microphones and we're going to ask you to share them. All right, I need somebody who's in touch with their inner child to read the part of my sister, Bic, and also a very small line as my cousin in America. Oh, great, great, great. Come on down. We'll put you here next to your parents. What's your name?
I'm Jimmy.
Jimmy? Hey, Jimmy, do you think you could play all the kids? It's really easy. So the baby, he just has two lines and they're both crying. And in the striped shirt is my sister, Bic, again. And that's my sister, Lam. And that's little me. Yeah? Just all of them. Great. Okay. Okay, a small part as the diver lady in the camp and these lost women in the airport. Someone who's familiar with reading comics would be good, because it can be a little bit confusing to follow the words. Yes, fantastic. Come on down. Okay, I have another child's part, actually, this little lost boy named Vu. You can't, oh yeah, okay, I was gonna say, you can't volunteer your friend. Okay, but you can. Okay, great, come on down. So you just have to remember that your first line, what's your name? Samu, your first line is off screen, so you won't see yourself, but your first line is Bic from Aurora School, okay? And just remember that B-I-C-H is pronounced Bic. All right, who can do a really good French accent?
Oh.
Or a really bad French accent is cool too. It's just a one line, yeah? Okay. Anybody? I need a character actor who can actually play three different
men.
Do I see a hand up there?
He's up there.
Where? Wave your hand. Oh, okay, great, thank you. So you're gonna be the French priest, my uncle Hai, and this elderly man in the airport. And thank you so much. Okay, I need an authoritative voice to be the doctor who gives some bad news and then some good news. Oh, fantastic, come on over. And I need a Red Cross worker. You just have to point and yell a little bit. Oh, Oh, yes, come on down. And then the last roll goes to a very earnest hippie from the Midwest named Tom Rivers, charity worker. Anybody, last chance? Yes, come on down. Okay, I'm gonna just backtrack and do some roll call here so that you can test your microphone and learn a Vietnamese word. So when I call your part, I'm gonna say, for example, Ma, and you're gonna say Ma Day. Day means here, okay? All right, and speak into your microphone so you can make sure that it works. All right, Ma?
Hello.
Ma Day.
Ah, excellent. Bo?
Ma Day.
Oh no, you say Bo Day.
Bo Day.
It's cool. We're all family here. Bick?
Bick Day.
Okay, and cousin and all the kids. Okay. Diver. Who's the diver? Diver and the women in the airport. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Diver Day.
Diver.
Day.
Diver Day.
Excellent. Vũ.
Vũ Day.
Oh my gosh. Somebody give this man a diacritical award. Come. French Piste.
French Piste Day.
Nice. Okay. Doctor.
Dr. Day.
Nice, southern accent. Red Cross worker.
Red Cross workers, Dai.
Nice, and Tom Rivers.
Tom Rivers, charity worker, Dai.
You're gonna be awesome. Okay. All right. Now everybody, I'm gonna take you across time and space to a refugee camp that no longer exists. To give you context, the year is 1978. I'm 3 years old. The Vietnam War ended in 1975. Americans left a little bit earlier than that. You have to remember that this was a civil war, which meant that half the country, after the war ended, was the losers. My family was on the side that lost. My parents, while they were idealistic, teachers who decided to stay behind to try to help rebuild the country found themselves unable to do that because they were part of the class of people called the Ngụy, which means like traitor, not to be trusted. So what that meant was my father was targeted to be sent to a re-education camp eventually. My mother continued teaching, but she had her curriculum handed to her, and it was all very, very different from what she had taught before. My sisters were not going to be allowed to go to school beyond the sixth grade, and we didn't have much of a future in store for us. So after 3 years of trying and becoming poorer and poorer through a series of currency exchanges that were designed to make the South poorer, my parents decided to try to escape the country illegally by boat, and their third attempt, they succeeded in getting us to Malaysia. My father heroically took over driving the boat 3 days and three nights till he got us to shore, where we were all promptly arrested and then taken to a refugee camp the next day run by the UNHCR. A refugee camp is a bottleneck of people seeking a new home. In March of 1978, when we arrived at Pulau Besar, there were already 3,000 people in the camp. Every week, a delegation came from a different country, France, Canada, Australia, the US, to interview people wanting to resettle there.
We'll go back to France. We speak the language.
Who do we know there, though?
Any choice was a gamble. My parents decided our futures on very little information.
You already have two sisters in America, and we know a little English. Maybe we could teach French in America.
For children, camp was in many ways a wonderful vacation. No school.
Let's watch the ladies dive for shellfish.
Want to ride on my back?
Yeah. Gonna practice floating.
An escape from regular life.
Big from Aurora School? Is that you?
Boo, what are you doing here? And why are you still wearing an old school uniform?
My family just arrived. They didn't tell me where we were going. They just picked me up from school one day. And now I'm here.
Can I have a little privacy, please?
For a while, there was the worry of how to have and care for a newborn baby in a refugee camp.
You speak wonderful French, madame. Surely someone like you has other resources.
Ma was so humiliated by having to beg and so upset at having her honesty questioned. She went into labor that evening.
And still no diaper.
Hold on, sis.
The baby.
Oh, that's you.
The
baby. The struggle to bring a life into the world is rewarded by that cry. It is a single-minded effort. Uncluttered and clear in its objective. What follows afterward, that is the rest of that child's life, is another story. Daily life was not easy. Water came out of ditches dug by previous residents and had to be boiled before drinking. Wood for boiling and cooking had to be gathered from the dwindling forest surrounding the camp. There were no proper toilets. But it would take us a little further out each day to relieve ourselves and bring back some firewood. Yet we were among the lucky ones. Our stay there was only a few months. One day, they called our names from the radio tower.
And says,
on the other side of the world, Ma's older sister Dao and her husband acted as our U.S. sponsors and processed all of our paperwork quickly. The Red Cross helped us get our plane tickets, and my parents promised to repay them once they had jobs. In Kuala Lumpur, we got our immunizations and our health cleared.
Ow!
Ouch.
Ouch.
All except for Bo.
There were scars on your lung x-ray. We need to stay close so we can take a closer look.
How long? My family leaves tomorrow.
I don't know. We'll have to wait and see.
They said their goodbyes at the church where we slept.
I borrowed $30 from an old student back at camp. Use some of it to buy some outfits for the kids. We don't need much else. Take this for your trip.
And then the next morning.
Does anyone here speak English?
A little.
That's great. We need you two to help this group get to where they're going.
But I have four children. But I have four children.
Don't worry, my wife and I can watch your kids.
There are about 100 people who needed Ma to show them to their gates, help them check in, and fill out forms. We sat with the elderly couple, absorbed by the Hershey bar that Ma had bought for us. Finally,
it's time for us to get it on the plane.
The flight attendant gave Ma a bassinet for the baby, but he cried every time she tried to put him down. She had only one cloth diaper for him, so every time he peed, she dried him with napkins and folded the cloth to move the wet spots.
Just don't poop, okay?
Miraculously, he didn't. My sisters and I got an airplane pin and juice, which kept us content. And then the chaos of getting in and out of Los Angeles. Customs, baggage, connecting flights.
You go to gate 7, over there, hurry, they're calling your flight. You go to terminal 3, follow the signs. Oh, wow.
Do you want me to do it? Okay. You go to gate 7, over there, hurry, they're calling your flight, okay. Wait, which way did you say, miss? You go to terminal 3, follow the signs. No, please, miss, take us there. We're scared we'll get lost.
After helping everyone else, Ma realized,
oh no, our flight's about to leave.
Finally, on June 28th, 1978, we arrived at Chicago O'Hare Airport. My sister Dao and one of her daughters were there to meet us.
Welcome to America.
Meanwhile, back in Kuala Lumpur.
You have scars from tuberculosis, but no infection. You are cleared to go.
At Kuala Lumpur Airport, like Ma, Bo was called upon to use his, bless you, limited English to help the other refugees traveling.
Listen, there's been an airline strike. We all had to get new tickets. I had to get you all new tickets.
In Los Angeles, distracted by the needs of others, Bo actually did miss his own flight.
No, what do I do?
Through broken English, a lot of gesturing, and eventually a supervisor who spoke French, Bo got on a late flight to Anchorage, Alaska. He spent his first night in America on a bench in the airport. Bo's attempts to call my sister on a payphone were unsuccessful. His experience in Los Angeles left him too nervous to leave his waiting area to go buy food. When he finally arrived at Chicago O'Hare Airport, his belly was as empty as his morale was low. Oh, Tom Rivers.
Oh. Hey, man. Excuse me, are you from Vietnam?
Yes.
Rad. Tom Rivers from U.S. Catholic Charities. I come out here every day to see if there are any other refugees arriving. Where are you going? Unbelievable. I know that man. I go to his house every day for a bowl of pho.
Why is it so ugly here?
Ha, ha, ha. You don't like it?
Hammond, Indiana. 2 hours later.
Surprise.
Oh my God.
That night, we slept reunited under the same roof in a new country. Me, my baby brother, Bo, and Ma, and Lan and Bick in a 2-bedroom house with my aunt, her husband, their 5 children, and 1 dog. I want to take a second to thank the amazing readers tonight. You were really good. Thank you for doing the improv, figuring out your parts. It's kind of like real life, right? Like, what do I do? You all get diacritical awards tonight. But I also want to present to you the book Out of Order. I told it Out of Order, which messes up some readers, but come on, guys, it's literature. If this were a Hollywood movie about refugees, this would be around the time when the violin music starts playing, everybody hugs each other, and they all live happily ever after. But those of us who went through the real life experience know that life doesn't just stop once you get to the new place. It keeps going, and sometimes it's really, really hard. So here's the epilogue. In San Diego, California, because we left the Midwest, it was cold. 1 year later. Was Bo so terrible? It's hard to remember. My memories of him live in an orange apartment building in San Diego, California. I remember blinding concrete and the rectilinear shapes of lawns and parking lots, bottle brush and cypress, these stairs, and the claustrophobic darkness inside our home. I remember streets named after states and schools named after presidents, and imagine each block, each day turned us a little more American. The same month we moved into the orange building, a 16-year-old girl in San Diego aimed her rifle at the elementary school children across the street from her house, killing 2 people and injuring 9. The mayor at the time was Pete Wilson, the same California governor I would hate many years later for backing one of the most anti-immigrant laws in history. San Diego was a Naval and Marine Corps base where the wounds of the Vietnam War were still fresh, and not everyone welcomed our presence. I learned about America mostly through books and TV and from what my sisters learned in school. Every morning we have to say, I pledge allegiance to the flag, one nation, under God, indivisible. And as though this induction into Americanhood needed any more nudging. You stupid goop. There were reasons to not want to be anything other. For my parents, already fully formed in another time and place to which they could never go back, home became the holding pen for the frustrations and the unexercised demons that had nowhere to go in America's finest city. So there's a lot we could talk about in terms of intergenerational trauma and mental health and how our refugee communities often don't access mental health services. But I wanted to talk about just give you a quick survey of some of the work that I have touched upon since finishing The Best We Could Do. One of them was to tell a refugee story about Vietnamese refugees who settled in Minnesota by the poet Bao Phi. And I just got to draw the pictures and kind of talk about, without using words, the spaces in between family members and the things that your parents don't tell you and how that affects you anyway, but also the bond between family members that happens anyway and the stuff that you do together, like maybe getting up before dawn to go fishing for your family's food. Is anybody here a fan of the show Stranger Things? Yeah, me too. I love the nostalgia trip that it gives you. And I wanted to give that to Vietnamese American refugees, because like we were around at that time, but we don't really figure into the Stranger Things plot summary. So I was like, how does Vietnamese American refugee nostalgia look? Well, for me, it's like hand-me-down clothes from the church, so like clothes from the 70s that you wore in the 80s. But like for me, some of the geographical differences made me have to Google things, because I grew up in sunny California. That's me and my brother. Bao grew up in the Midwest, so while we did have things in common, like I asked him, what are some things you remember, like objects you remember that I could draw in the end papers? He was like, the nước mắm that my mom would mix in an old Miracle Whip jar. I was like, okay, I know what that looks like. But did your mom cut the carrots in flowers or in sticks? And he said, flowers. I was like, okay, gotcha. But he said other things like tater tot hot dish, which I had to Google. I remember like the free calendar from the supermarket. That would be like the only decoration on the wall. So for us, like the sparseness was part of our home decor, and that was a signature look. So while I'm hugely inspired by Maurice Sendak's book In the Night Kitchen, which like is filled with the ephemera that he collected in his lifetime, that like really gives me like this close, intimate connection with like Jewish American life in New York in like the 1950s, right? I don't have any personal experience with that, but I feel so intimately connected through art, and I wanted to, through art, make that for Vietnamese American refugees. More recently, I got to contribute to a book of refugee essays called The Displaced, and I happened to be traveling for field research in Indonesia and Vietnam at the time. So I just did this contrast of me traveling light in 2017 and what a luxury it is to have like a US passport. And the things I fit in my little suitcase include my new pad and my old iPad and some duty-free whiskey and chocolates. Whereas when my mother traveled light as a refugee in 1978, she had 5 ID cards, 1 change of clothes per person, and her luxury was 10 limes and a bag of sugar for making lemonade when we arrived. I also did this illustration just thinking about what current refugees leave behind, because it's sometimes easy to judge them for like not, you know, catching up with everybody really fast. But when you think about all the things that you leave behind, it's not just the obvious things like your family and friends and language. It's also like knowing how to take the bus, knowing where to get your food, knowing how to do simple things. The reason I was in Vietnam was because I was trying to research climate change there, and I was in the Mekong Delta mostly, trying to interview farmers about the sea level rise affecting their crops. The thing is, Vietnamese people are so resilient that they weren't actually telling me very much. So I came back to the US and got bombarded with tweets and emails from Vietnamese Americans who were freaking out about the raids that were happening on Vietnamese communities across the US. People were getting rounded up by ICE, getting arrested by ICE, and then getting locked up to be removed, deported back to Vietnam. And all of these people had fled as refugees. So this is something that I didn't know much about, but I read really fast. And the more I read, the madder I got. And the more I understood that there's a complex system of laws that create this sort of double jeopardy situation for people. They're in trouble with the law. They serve their sentences. Many times their sentences are much longer than they should have been. And then they get punished a second time just because they weren't born here in the US. So the people that I talk to, they've been here all their lives. They have families. And the act of deportation would then rip them away from like 5-month-old babies and recontinue the cycle of violence and family separation that they've already gone through because of the Vietnam War. Some of the families that are fighting through the law have already lost somebody to deportation and they're trying to use the law to bring them back. I'm gonna skip this. So the question of how did these people, once accepted by America as refugees, end up begging to not be separated from their families again? And those questions led me down a rabbit hole of a lot of research into the laws that we passed in the 1990s under the Clinton administration. It's led me to understand better the infrastructure that was added to by the Obama administration, and then of course the new pressures added by the Trump administration, which puts at like between 8 and 10,000 Vietnamese Americans at risk, which adds to the numbers of Cambodians who have been at risk for over a decade already and have been deported in greater numbers. And this is now extending to people who came from Laos as well. Some of these folks who are still fighting their deportation cases have lived really violent lives, not just in the countries that they fled, but also in the US. PJ Borei experienced one of the first school shootings that's widely known about in the US. But as depressing as these stories are and as heavy as they are, I've actually been inspired by the people that I've been interviewing, because they're such survivors and they're such transformed humans that they are the best people I can imagine to be the counselors to try to help other people in their situation. And so I wanted to read you this quote from one of them. His name is Lee. He said, "We invest in people. We believe in the goodness that exists in people because we were also a group of people who waited 20 to 30 years, some longer, for others to invest in us, to see the value in us." I've also met really inspiring activists and organizers all through the US. And many people think of Asian Americans as more passive, less involved in politics. And I say no. I've met so many who are standing up for their rights and standing up for the people around them. And if the country is falling apart, if the world is falling apart, there's no place I'd rather be than with the people who are trying to do something about it. And then finally, going back to that image of the Syrian boy who died trying to get to safety, this notion of boat people has come back full circle. Vietnamese people are certainly not the only people who arrive by boat, and boat is certainly not the only dangerous way to get to America. The desert is often just as deadly as the sea. But these images really struck me because they look so similar to Vietnamese people in the 70s and early 80s. So I actually went to the island where many of them washed ashore in 2015, 2016. It's the one of the most eastern islands in Greece. It's only 4 kilometers away from Turkey at its closest point, which means that a lot of smugglers encourage people to take this route to try to get to Europe. So in 2015, 2016, like 5,000 people a day on average were washing ashore in these little tiny blow-up dinghies. And on one record summer day, 12,000 people washed ashore to this island of 90,000 residents. So I went there to see what it was like for people who had lived through that sort of end of the world experience and what it was like for the people who were still stuck in the refugee camps there. And I was actually surprised that there were not as many Syrians as I expected because they had been resettled in greater numbers. I think because people understood that there was this civil war and like these people deserved asylum. Many of the other people there came from African countries, and the vast majority of them, 75% at the time, were coming from Afghanistan, which meant that they'd been displaced for the last like 40 years in different countries. So this brings me back to the issue that I'd been thinking about over the last couple of years. How do I bring attention to these refugee crises that we have? And it's clearly a crisis because right now, according to the last UNHCR report, 70.8 million people in the world are displaced. And that doesn't even include about 5 million people from Venezuela currently. But what I realized is that that's 71 million people who are alive and have stories. So I don't need to sensationalize a little boy's death to draw your attention to it. I can interview people because that's what I know how to do. I can draw them. I can try to uplift their voices and their stories. In the mundane and sometimes funny and sensory ways that I figured out how to do for my family. And hopefully, in telling their stories this way, I make you feel something for them. And perhaps I also can connect my past experience with their current experience and help contextualize a large global event with an intimate family's experience so that when we make decisions about immigration policy, for example, we're not just reacting to this abstract notion of the other. We're really looking at individual people who are impacted. So maybe because it's going to be hard to advance some slides, I'm going to just make a plug for 3 things before I sit down with Paisley. Like Lehua said, I got to make a book with my son, who's the older child there, and Viet Thanh Nguyen, the Pulitzer Prize-winning author of The Sympathizer, and his adorable little boy named Ellison, who's actually the the person who came up with this story. Viet and I would not have come up with a story about pirates because, you know, Vietnamese people are terrified of pirates. But my son illustrated the book. He did all the drawings, and I colored and lettered them. So it was a really great opportunity to do some work with him. I also want to make a plug for this amazing one-woman show called 140 Pounds. It's on national tour right now. Susan Liu is like our Ali Wong. She's doing this tour pregnant. And it's a really intense show about how she lost her mother to a botched surgery, plastic surgery, when she was only 11 years old. And this is her way of processing her grief and also answering some questions about herself and her mother, beauty standards, and this strange relationship that we had that she had with her mother. And that's my mother standing next to her. And then finally, because I do talk a lot about activism and politics, I would say that two organizations, if you're interested in getting either to know more about these issues or you want to do something, follow PIVOT, the Progressive Vietnamese American Organization, for information and leads to people on the ground who are doing this movement work. And then to CRAC, the Southeast Asian Resource Action Center, which is based in Washington, D.C., and does amazing work through legislation on behalf of Southeast Asians. So without further ado, I'm going to move over to there, and Paisley is going to do her thing. And then we'll open it up to your questions as well. Thank you.
This on now? Oh, okay. Hi, I'm Paisley Rechtal. I'm a professor of English at the University of Utah. So I'm going to ask a few questions. We'll have a bit of a conversation. Then I want to open it up to you guys. And there will be mics floating around the audience. So if you have a question, just raise your hand, and we'll send a mic to you. I do want to insist that these be questions. And I know everyone has lots of things that they want to say. But do make it a question. So. I lied, I said I was gonna throw out some lowball questions, but I was so taken by all the things you were saying, and of course, there's so much to talk about with intergenerational trauma, and then of course the ways in which refugees get depicted. And so my question is actually a pretty difficult philosophical one, right? But your memoir definitely talks about and thinks about the ways in which refugees get traumatized potentially and pass that down. Through cultural narratives, through the stories that we tell ourselves and our families, but also potentially through some genetic inheritance too. And that raises a really fascinating philosophical question about the idea of representing refugees, right? Especially at this time of global refugee crisis. So I'm curious about your thoughts, especially in a culture right now that might not be the most positive around issues of immigration. How do we be both honest about the ways that trauma is experienced and maybe becomes part of a culture at the same time persuade people to say, this is important that we take refugees in?
Right.
It is yours on?
Yeah. Hello, okay. It is super tricky. At a time when there are some very harsh narratives about refugees and who they are, there's a tendency to go, no, they're good refugees and good citizens. But when you do that, then you start to divide the refugee population up. Like, okay, these are the good ones, so that we'll throw these ones under the bus in order to save a few. And that's very problematic, because then, like, who gets to decide? Right? So is it just the ones who have jobs and go to church and have families? Like, what about the single men? What about the people who have been incarcerated? What about the people with mental health? So how do you treat them compassionately as well? How do you not let go of them? And how do you, like, use your political power to say, no, all of us? So I try to encourage people to, just accept that Vietnamese refugees are like everybody else. Some of them are really extraordinary, and some are absolutely ordinary, and then some are real assholes, you know, just like everybody else. Because if you just put them on a pedestal and you always show them in their sad refugee photos so that, you know, you pull at people's heartstrings and they pull out their wallets and all that stuff, you dehumanize them in this other weird way, and then it becomes confusing when they arrive and they're jerks, right? Or they have problems. But ultimately, like, you have to decide, okay, what is being humane? It is like, if you have room, you make space, right? And then also realizing that in many cases, people who are fleeing their countries to come here are coming here because we, the US, were there interfering with their countries. So there is a global responsibility when you have a large footprint.
Yeah. I was really struck by something you said also, where you were showing the picture of the young boy who was this young Syrian boy who died. With that image went viral. I think we all recognize it. And when you look especially at images of the Southeast Asian refugees in post-1975, what's really interesting to me is how often they focused in on children mm-hmm. and young people as this idea of, well, they're assimilatable. You know, we can make them American citizens. And they didn't show images of young men, and they didn't show images of people who, or men who look like they came from battle or something like that, right? This idea that to make refugees as non-threatening as possible.
Right.
And I'm curious about if you see a pattern like that now, I think, in the way that we portray refugees in the popular culture.
I see it all the time. Children always get photographed, one, because they love cameras, and they're curious and they're cute. So
I think non-threatening.
They're non-threatening. So a lot of times when Westerners come into these situations, they gravitate towards the children and they take a lot of photos of the children, and that ends up, like, little children end up being like our image that we were given of a much more complicated situation, right? Because these children come from families. So a lot of times, yes, single men traveling alone are seen as threats, often by other refugees as well. Mm-hmm. But, you know, with Muslim refugees, oftentimes, like, the women are seen as a threat because they look different with their headscarf. So I've seen them singled out as well.
One of the things that I love about the memoir is the way that patterns and repetition kind of work, kind of as a device, a formal device, but also speaking, I think, very powerfully to the ways that there is a kind of repetition in traumatic storytelling and trauma in general. Like, you begin with this, with birth, the birth of your son, and the sort of fear that you have there, and that sort of takes you back into your family narrative about all the things that they went through, and then the ways that war continues to sort of percolate through the family narrative, and movement and migration continues to percolate through the family narrative. So I'm curious, like, how long did it take you to figure out the narrative structure for how to tell that memoir, like, to get that patterning sort of visible?
Super long. Chapter 2 was like, it's like the Bermuda Triangle. Every time I edited it, I was like lost again, because it's like the thesis chapter, right? It's mm-hmm. in which T states her problem, and I got really nervous when I introduced a conflict that I hadn't resolved in real life, which was my conflict with my mother. But I decided to just go there and use the book as a vehicle to ask the questions. Definitely going backwards in time felt important to me, to be like revealing of the whole process of like figuring out your family story. It is a backwards moving process, peeling away the layers, and going backwards through your own experience and using that experience to try to relate to your parents. Mm-hmm. Then coming back full circle, but being changed at the end is a narrative structure that I end up using a lot.
Yeah. I also want to ask just two more questions, I swear. I'm not going to monopolize her. I will get to you, though really, honestly, I don't want to. But two questions. One, the coloration is so good and so simple. And can you talk a little bit about how you saw color and coloring the different panels and how that worked with telling this story?
I am a minimalist at heart, and it's also helpful when you haven't colored a book before to just use one. I'm also a refugee, so it's also cheap to just use one color. I mean, it's not like that orange was on sale or anything. It's like the cheapest way to make a comic book is in black and white, right? So My contract was for a 320-page black and white book, but like halfway through the process, I asked them, could we have any color? And they did some research into the printing process and what it would cost, and they came back with, you can afford one color. So I went through the entire Pantone uncoded library, and I did a test. I did some test prints of like, I don't know, four or five different colors on three different kinds of paper before I found that like sort of sepia tone that for me represents nostalgia and memory, and also kind of looks like the orange apartment building, and and like the discoloration that you get on your photographs from the 70s and 80s.
And in certain panels, I always said to you before, it looks almost like blood, like a sort of remnants of a blood stain, especially when you've got the panels about war. So it really works quite well on
a lot
of
levels.
Yeah,
those were some happy painting accidents where I was like, ooh, cool.
Yeah. How honest do you think your parents were with you when you were interviewing them for this project?
I once heard my mom say in front of an audience, we told Tia the truth and she wrote down whatever she wanted. And then, but then like at the same event, then she said it was 99% true. Mm. So I think that they tried hard. And I also like interrogated them like over and over and over again to try to fact check them and like iron out the contradictions that they had. Because it's tricky, and I think I would be a terrible interviewee. Because I don't remember things linearly, and I can't remember exact years, so you would definitely have to fact check me.
And memory is so powerful in the piece because, of course, they're caught in some ways in between countries, between time periods. They're sort of caught in a land of memory. So this idea of, like, can they be honest, too? Can they tell the whole story? Because they're always kind of reimagining and coming back to those memories. Okay, I swear to God, I'm going to you. All right, so... if you have questions, please raise your hand. Someone will come. All right, here comes number one, Jay Jordan. Stand up, Jay.
Hi, thank you so much for sharing the book. My son and I both want to read it. He came with me. I said, you got to come. And he's like, okay, yeah, this is really good. I thanks in no small part to the Asia Center, actually. I recently had an opportunity to spend some time in Thailand and in Myanmar. And one of the things that I learned about Thailand while I was there, because I was working in a writing workshop with a group of social science scholars, is that regionally, throughout that part of Asia, there's a lot of migration happening. In part, it's refugees from Myanmar along the Thai-Burma border and other areas. Mm-hmm. And there's also a fair amount of economic migration going on. And so countries that might have at one point, and still to some extent are, will be sending countries for migrants and potentially for refugees to the United States are now potentially beginning to receive more migrants themselves. Mm-hmm. And so I'm wondering if that, I mean, in contact that you have had ongoing in Vietnam, in other parts of Asia, in your own work or through connection with other agencies, if you've been able to see anything about what's going on with that phenomenon and what the effects are like? What happens, for example, when a country that, you know, might have lost a certain amount of its population is beginning to now see an influx of a different population?
It's so hard. If you look at the list of the top 10 countries in terms of the number of refugees that they take in, the U.S. is nowhere near there. Actually, most Western countries are not on that list. Germany is the only one. Most of them are countries like Jordan, Turkey, Uganda, Chad, countries that you don't expect because they don't have the same resources that we do to be offering refugee services. So sometimes it's a hot mess in those countries where there's not even room to create camps anymore. So like in Jordan, I just learned, Jordan has like one of the largest refugee camps like in the world. I think it houses like 400,000 people, but that's not enough. So like 85% of the refugee population in Jordan is like just living in Jordan in the cities, and that makes it really hard to offer services in a streamlined way. So clearly, like there are countries that are under-resourced that are carrying the largest burden of taking care of displaced people. And so Western countries basically, in a nutshell, need to step up.
I thought I saw a hand. Oh, great.
Yes, my name is Floyd Morey. Excuse me. Born and raised here in Utah. But at time of my life in the 70s, I was living in California and was elected to the state legislature in California way back then. And one of the first events that occurred when I was in office was the refugees from Vietnam came to the United States. And I was one of the only Asian state legislators, so I felt a need to go down and welcome them. So I went down to Camp Pendleton, and the image that I saw of rows and rows of tents out in the middle of basically nowhere really gave me an affinity to the Vietnamese community, because that was the time that in our Japanese American community, we were talking about the concentration camps of World War II, where there were barracks lined up and people were forced to live in these barracks. And so as my life went on from 40 years ago, I've had the opportunity to work with, and I've been attracted to work with, the Vietnamese people along the coast in New Orleans when Katrina hit. Mm-hmm. There was a big issue in Georgia when there was a church there that was they were gonna build a garbage dump right next to the church, and we helped them oppose that. But my point is that this image really gave me an affinity to the Vietnamese people. Now, as you've traveled the world, what kind of images have you seen that remind you of your past and your parents' past, the refugee experience, that gives you an affinity to other people other than your own community?
For me, it's human relationships. Definitely, like the image of the boat, and you know, for Vietnamese people and for Syrian people, and so many of the other folks who came to Greece by boat. But for me, it's something even more universal, which is like a mother carrying her child, or a father trying to keep his family together. It's all of the ways that they talk about their loved ones and how they're just trying to get to somewhere safer for their loved ones. That, for me, is the universal thread that I keep hearing over and over and over again. And I was talking to some women from the Congo who had gone through so many borders to get to Turkey, and they told me in Turkey they were arrested, and one of them she was allowed to go to a hospital to give birth by C-section so it would be fast. And then they sent her back to prison with her newborn infant after a C-section with no antibiotics or painkillers. And then so she said, like, man, the journey to Greece was easy compared to that. I had nothing to say to her, because I was like, that sounds way harder than anything my family went through. But I just decided to show her that picture of my mom holding me in the refugee camp, and she smiled. And she was with a bunch of mothers, and they all smiled because they saw their kids in that picture of me, and they saw me happy and thriving. And so they felt like, oh, okay, all of our hardships are gonna pay off. They felt hope. And then I decided I wanted to show them a picture of my mom now too, also thriving in her own way, so that they could reserve some hope for themselves too. To me, those like human relationships and the parents who are trying to do something for their kids, that's the thing that I think about the most.
We have time for two more questions, I think. Is anyone up there? Okay. If anyone else wants to get themselves on the list, do raise your hand so we can. All right, great.
I was struck by the fact that your father had so much difficulty getting to where he needed to be, and he tried to communicate with a gate agent and still didn't really end up getting the help that he needed. I'm curious to know if the federal government has something established, like a 24-hour hotline with interpreter services now, to assist people as they're traveling, you know, when there's problems, and, you know, what has been established that way?
I don't think that the federal government really prioritizes refugee services currently, but there are fortunately a lot of private and church-funded organizations that still do that good work. IRC, the International Rescue Committee, does a lot of great work. The International Office of Migration is usually like the organization that helps people before they arrive in the host country. So there are people, but there's no like there's no federal agency that does that.
Last question, and then afterwards over there. Okay, last question over there. Okay, and then after this, T is going to generously sign books, so definitely come up and get a book signed, I think, out in the lobby.
I had a question about your influences as a cartoonist and as a maker of comics. I wondered if you could comment on that. And then in particular, in the US, we sort of have this long tradition of comics originally were seen as this sort of vulgar art form for the crude masses, right? And many Jewish and Italian Americans in the 30s and 40s and into the 50s were doing them because they couldn't get their novels published and they couldn't get their screenplays taken seriously, right? And so it's always been a form, I think, in the US that attracts sort of people in liminal spaces or on the edges of American culture. And I wonder if you could just speak to that.
Thank you, I love that question. I love how lowbrow comics are. Because it's a really sneaky way to get people to read history and like about issues, you know? Because it looks like a very emotional family story. And I have some things to say about like women being pushed into writing memoirs as well. So it's basically a Trojan horse for making you all read about the Vietnam War and a bunch of history. And I definitely love the sneak attack, and I also love that it's a really cheap way to make a movie, right? Like no other decision makers really but yourself. And you don't need a lot of money, you just need time and some drawing ability. But you can tell these very complex stories just with sequential images. It took me a long time to figure out the art form. I think I felt comfortable by chapter 8 of 10. I think like there's a meter to writing comics that I really love. That's like maybe the only thing I know about poetry. and there is like, there's a lot you can do with camera angles and the way that you draw people. The more simple you draw them, the more universal they become and the more they can convey feelings. So it helps me get around the problem of representation because we're such a media saturated culture that sometimes like we don't feel anything when we see photographs, but when we see drawings in sequence, they draw us into a story in a more intimate way maybe.
I always think of the gutter as a very lyric device anyway. Yeah. I think it's really beautiful. But I'm just going to say that to plug poetry. Anyway, thank you so much for this wonderful talk. And thank you all for coming. She will be signing books outside, so please get a copy if you don't already. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.